Today, we want to talk about Psalm 23, a promise and a word. You know, throughout the years that we've been giving a State of the Church address, I don't know that any of them have actually had the bearing on us or have resonated in a way like this particular one has. I hope you see there's something really different about this message. And I think it's so precious of the Lord to begin this message with Psalm 23 and to tell us right up front that this psalm is His promise, He says in the message, His promise to us and His word to us for 2023. So obviously there is a tremendous amount, a treasure trove of insights into this psalm that we need to discover, we need to grab hold of it, we need to pull it to our bosom, we need to understand, we need to be able to appropriate it to ourselves and understand totally what the Lord is giving us, what He's saying to us, what belongs to us, what He said this word really is, and to help us understand what He says He will do when He quotes to us Psalm 23. So let's read Psalm 23 together as they put it on the screen. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you. Now, as most of us learned that through the King James Version, and of course, in learning it, the part that kind of stands out with us, that grabs our attention, is that surely goodness and mercy is the way that most of us learned it. But let me help you understand why they might be using the word loving kindness in the New American Standard version of this. Mercy means someone loving so much that it deals with our forgiveness and how it's shown to us by someone when it's within their power to put on us guilt or harm toward us. And so the Lord shows us mercy so that He is not showing, going to give any of that to us. But the word loving kindness means tenderness, giving oneself fully with love and compassion. And it talks about the steadfast love of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's one thing, we know that His mercy is what got us to the place that you and I can even come to heaven and our sins are forgiven. But we're talking about every day of our life to have that tenderness, that loving care of the Lord with us, that is His compassion, that His love is so steadfast that no one could ever move us away from His love. You know that David, of course, is the author of this psalm, and he himself was a shepherd as a youth. And during the many hours, of course, that he was out on the hillside or wherever he might be taking care of the father's sheep, he spent a great deal of time praising the Lord. Now, when you read all of the psalms, most of them, of course, written by David, when you do, it's like looking into his personal prayer book. So I'm sure he had no idea that you and I, all these many years later, would be inspired by what he wrote in those many, many psalms. So here we are. You and I, a part of the end time remnant. And it just thrilled me that in the 2023 message, he kept reassuring us that he is coming and that we are that last time generation. There's never been a time like this. There's never been a people like us. Glory to God that he would classify us again as part of the end time remnant. and that he chose one of David's songs as his word and his promise in this year of 2023. There are two sections to this psalm. In verses 1 through 4, David reveals God to us as a shepherd who provides and protects his sheep. In verses 5 through 6, he presents God to us as a host at a wonderful banquet, the marriage supper of the Lamb, glory to God. And he invites us to participate in it. Oh, I'm all for it, Jesus, hallelujah. Both of these roles are really familiar with David because David was a shepherd out on the hillside. And later in his life, of course, as he became king, he knew what it was to host many a banquet. Yet in this psalm, David does not see himself as a shepherd. He does not even see himself as king. He sees himself as a sheep. And that's the way he presents it. So the psalm opens with the words, "The Lord is my shepherd." Now the word in Hebrew, this is pretty fascinating, that David used here is not Adonai, which one usually associates with that English word, Lord. That's not what we're looking at here. Rather, David says, "Yahweh is my shepherd." Yahweh happens to be the most sacred, the most awesome of the names of God. It declares his absolute otherness. In other words, I am who I am. In other words, nothing, there's no word, there's nothing, no way to compare who he is. And of course, the first time we ever saw that revelation of Yahweh is really found in the book of Exodus. You remember when Moses heard the voice of God and he said that he was coming when he went up to see the burning bush and he commissioned him to go and deliver Israel. Now, let's look what it says in Exodus 3, 13 through 14. Then Moses said to God, "Behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. Now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent you, sent me to you." My goodness, let me give you a better understanding. This is what God is really saying. I am who I am from all eternity to all eternity. The awesome, the eternal, the all-knowing, the ever-present, the fully compassionate, the abundantly loving God. That's who I've been, that's who I am, and that's who I will forever be. So first of all, David declares, the Lord Yahweh himself, he is my shepherd. And just the way that he's saying, as he watched over his father's sheep, he's actually saying, so does the Lord shepherd me. Do you think that David knew that he was speaking prophetically? I doubt it, you know. And do you think that he was living prophetically? I doubt any of that. We don't know, but a prophetic picture of Jesus is described in this psalm. That is for sure. How easy it was, in all honesty, for the disciples to recognize what Jesus was saying in John 10, 14 through 15. "I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me, I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." Now, remember, when Jesus gave that message to them, they understood. They had the Psalms. They had read the Psalms. They had a far better understanding than you and I, because we don't go out on the hillside and see very many shepherds leading their dumb sheep around. Hallelujah. So the highest priority of the shepherd was to train the lambs to recognize his voice so that as they matured, they would obey him. That was the key that kept them safe. And it actually kept them alive. Jesus said in John 10, 27, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." Now, that's a pretty slap you in the face verse. Is anybody paying attention to it? You know, he's decreeing over them that those who hear his voice are his sheep. The sheep, when you are submitted to the shepherd, you then will begin to hear his voice. We're going to talk a little more in detail about how you can hear his voice. The simple truth is that we only recognize the voices of those with whom we spend time. Amen. I mean, that's the bottom line. You learn to know the voice of the shepherd by investing time in his presence and time in his word, because the Lord is not going to contradict his word. So our first insight into Psalm 23 is this: our shepherd is the very king of the universe, the Almighty, the everlasting God, the Prince of Peace, the one who holds the universe in his hands and who sustains everything by the word of his power. That's who our shepherd is. And the second insight is that this shepherd is our provider. And look at the words: the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The word of God testifies in the word of Paul, Philippians 4:19. And my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. The problem is there's the difference between needs and wants. Matthew 6:7-8. And when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition as the Gentiles do, for they suppose that they will be heard for their many words. So do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Now, you know, we could just simply say, don't be a nag. Church, make sure you're settled the following in your own heart and mind, and this is this: my God loves me unconditionally, and he is utterly trustworthy. Yes. Therefore, I will trust him unconditionally. Amen. His promise is that no matter what comes along in the weeks and months ahead, he will watch over you, care for you, he will protect you, and he will provide for you. So you need to write that on the tablet of your heart. In other words, you can utterly trust him because his integrity is absolutely impeccable. I mean, if he said it, he is going to do it. And you got to get that in your heart that that's true.
Do you ever feel like nothing in your life is working right? Jesus laid out a plan so that your life can be totally and completely victorious. By ordering Sandra's CD series, Why Isn't It Working?, you will receive four powerful messages that will teach how to let God take control of your past, your hurts, your dreams, everything in your life, so that you can propel to a life of victory. Request offer 122 by calling or order online at sandrakennedy.org.
So the next three verses, David then describes what the shepherd does for his sheep. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. So we could say it this way: the shepherd provides rest for me. Sheep find it difficult to rest for four reasons: fear, insects, distractions, and tensions. Now, if the sheep sense something around them that makes them afraid, they will not lie down. If they're bothered by flies and mosquitoes, they will not lie down to sleep. If distraction causes them to feel uncomfortable, tense, or any anxiety of any kind, they will refuse to sleep. And if they're hungry, they absolutely will not lie down and sleep. Do you recognize yourself, church? Do you see yourself in those areas?
Amen.
Now, our good shepherd does for us everything that the earthly shepherd did for his flock. He will take care of the flies and mosquitoes of life. And what are they? All those agitations of life. Those things we have to deal with that just irritate us half to death. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I mean, it just gets on your last nerve. He makes me lie down in green pastures. It means that Jesus will handle your tensions, your worries, and your problems. Amen. Did you notice that it says, he makes me lie down?
Yeah.
Most of the time he has to make us chill out. Pay attention to where he makes us lie down. green pastures, and beside still waters. Now, green pastures are where sheep find the best food, and still waters are where they satisfy their thirst. So what does all this mean? It means we need to consistently feed on the Word of God if we're going to be spiritually healthy. We need to consistently drink the pure water of the Word. We need to do that. And what was the warning in the 2023 message? Do you remember? Be forewarned so that you are forearmed. In this year, so saith the Lord, in this year, demonic forces will war against your private devotions. They will war against your commitment to abide in His Word. They will war against your study of the Word of God. Now, He's already told us this is not a might. He's saying, this is going to happen. Some of you, you know, are saying, well, He's been warring against me on those my whole life. Well, the devil has, but grab hold. Obviously, it's going to intensify. He leads us to still waters, it says, to a place of mental and emotional rest, where He calms that storm and that's raging inside of you. He says, I'm giving it to you. Embrace it.
Yes.
In other words, remind yourself that it's there. As we do, he does the next thing that David wrote. He restores my soul.
Yes.
Let's face it, church. It's our soul that causes us all the trouble.
Yes.
Lord have mercy. Our mind and our emotions have a singular ability to turn us away from God's will. I mean, your mind can take you places you do not want to go.
Amen.
This is what Paul wrote about in 2 Corinthians 10:5. We are destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God, and we're taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. And he said, he also wrote, we have the mind of Christ. You know, Philippians 4:8 is the place to go. You know, finally, brethren, whatsoever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good report, if there's any excellence or if anything worthy of praise, think on these things.
Amen.
Dwell on those things. Dwell on those things. Your shepherd wants you to know to the core of your being that he is able and willing to take all of your problems, all of your hurts and disappointments, all of your guilt, all of your shame, all of your fears and worries, and lead you into such a place of confidence and trust in Him that you mature into an abiding supernatural rest. Now, that's what He said. Tell them this. So, isn't that what He said He would do? Make us unshakable, immovable, unflappable. That's what He said He would do. Psalm 37:7. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who carries out wicked schemes. Don't worry about all those folks. There's a payday someday. That's my interpretation of that. Isaiah 30:15. For thus the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, has said, in repentance and rest you will be saved. In quietness and trust is your strength, but you are not willing. We have to be willing for Him to take us to these places. Hebrews 4:1. Therefore, let us fear if while a promise remains of entering His rest, any one of you may seem to have come short of it. I want that place of rest.
Amen.
How does the Lord restore your soul? He says, He guides me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Sheep has a continual tendency to wander away. Isaiah described it this way, Isaiah 53. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Praise God forevermore. I love that scripture.
Amen.
As the good shepherd, he knows exactly how to get us back in line when we strayed off the path of righteousness. That's why he gave us the Holy Spirit as our path keeper. When we get out of line with God, the Holy Spirit's right there to gently nudge us back to our place in the sheepfold. And He does it for our good and for His name's sake. You see, the integrity of His name is manifest every time He moves in your life, doing what He promised to do. And then it says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, I want you to notice that it's not the valley of death you might walk through. It's just a shadow.
Amen.
In other words, the shadow of a flame cannot burn you.
Amen.
The shadow of a bear cannot bite you. A shadow simply says there's something out there, but it's not touching me. That's why we can walk through a difficult time and have no fear. Because it's not death we're walking through, it's the shadow of death. And because David says you're walking through a valley, it means that you're not meant to stay there. The good thing about a valley is that it's just the low point between two high points. So as long as you keep walking and don't set up camp in the valley, you'll end up on the mountaintop.
Amen.
Every single time.
Amen.
Then He says, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Every shepherd has two tools, a rod with a long stick used to fight off wolves and other predators who try to steal a sheep. And then the staff, on the other hand, was used to corral the sheep and to get them back in line whenever they stray. Your shepherd has conquered the forces of darkness and given us His Spirit to keep us in line whenever we stray. He protects us from the wolves, and He even protects us from ourselves.
Amen.
How many of you know you need protection from you?
Yes.
I mean, our biggest problems we produce ourselves. Now, that's the truth. So if we trust Him and obey Him, you're going to come out victorious. There's no way not to.
Amen.
The problem is you try to figure out what a victory is. And His definition of a victory and yours may not be the same thing. But I promise you, His definition is what counts. Hallelujah. That's precisely what He meant when He said in John 10:10, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came, He said, that you may have life. And I want you to have it abundantly. I don't want you to just barely make it. So when we get to verses 5 and 6 of Psalm, the scene shifts. David sees himself no longer as a sheep outside in the fields with his shepherd, but as a guest inside a banquet that is hosted by his shepherd. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. In other words, he will see it that those who come against you will eventually have to acknowledge His love for you. Hallelujah. That day is coming. The great shepherd, the King of glory, says, come, I have a seat of honor prepared for you at my table. Come and dine with me. Don't waste your time and energy on the attacks coming against you. I'll handle those, he says. You come and sit with me at my table. Rest in my presence. Let my peace pour totally over you.
Amen.
Let me anoint you with fresh oil, with a fresh touch of my spirit, so that your cup of joy overflows and the worries and anxieties of life are washed away. In the days of Jesus, hospitality was the utmost importance. When somebody came to your house as a mark of respect and honor for them, you would give them a guest, you'd give that guest some oil, and they would anoint their head with it. This is why in Luke 7, Jesus rebuked the Pharisee who failed to give him oil when he entered the house. Instead, a woman who was a sinner came with a vial, a very expensive perfume, if you remember, and anointed Jesus. When the Pharisee inwardly criticized not only the woman, but Jesus as well, then the Lord spoke up. Oh, you know what he said, but we pay attention. We put our attention on different parts of the scripture than he put his on. Luke 7, 40 through 46. And Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he replied, say it, teacher. A money lender had two debtors, one owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they were unable to pay, he graciously forgave them both. So which of them will love him more? Simon answered and said, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And he said to him, you've judged correctly. Turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but she, since the time I came in, has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with perfume. The Pharisee was guilty of a serious breach of traditional hospitality. We were talking about water, a kiss like the kiss on the cheek, water and oil. There are three things that were discussed here. And he's saying, you insulted the Lord by denying him the courtesy that he deserved. Jesus, on the other hand, will welcome us into his home with open arms to partake of this magnificent banquet that he has prepared for you, which the Word calls the marriage supper of the Lamb. But even before that great occasion, he continually prepares a banquet for us. Right now, where we are, he does it. He's constantly faithful, abundantly compassionate, and lovingly protective. For addition to all he's done and is doing, David cries out in the final verse, surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Notice that David said, it will follow me. And not just for a day or two, but all the days of my life. Amen. And if that wasn't enough, the psalm ends with an eternal promise. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The last verse of this psalm reminds me of what Paul said, Colossians 3:2. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things of this earth. This world truly is not our home. In giving us Psalm 23 as our psalm for this year, the Lord has blessed us with some key insights into his goodness and his faithfulness. Whatever events or whatever situations we face, we have a good shepherd whose character you can trust, whose faithfulness is unquestioned, and whose love is without limit. So, surely goodness and loving mercy will follow us all the days of our lives, and we will dwell with him forever and ever and ever. Amen. Glory to his holy name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord.